My brothers and sisters, in our first reading from the prophet Joshua, we find ourselves in Shechem. Shechem was a major city in the land of Canaan and one of the most important Israelite cultural and political centers, where we hear Joshua bring the people together and give them a choice not to worship Yahweh. What we are witnessing here is the coming together of a people not united by kinship or shared experience. These were people from many different walks of life, but they're brought together by their communal acceptance of Yahweh as their God. We are witnessing here what's called the covenant at Shechem, where the people of Israel are professing their promise to God. The covenant between the people of Israel and God. This community, united by a single common God, prefigures the emerging early Christian community given birth by our Lord Jesus Christ and nurtured by the disciples we'll meet in the gospel momentarily. But before we get there, we encounter a very important message in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. The radical thrust of this message is directed toward those who have authority and power. We learn that Christian authority or power springs first out of a greater obligation to love. Love. Paul also connects the relationship of bride and bridegroom to the relationship of Christ with his church. Paul reveals that just as a husband loves his wife, so does Christ love his bride, the church. And as a wife is subject to her husband in mutual love, so the church is subject to Christ. Just as Eve was created out of the rib of Adam, flesh of my flesh, so was the church created out of the blood and water that flowed from our Lord's side as he hung upon the cross. This marriage of our Lord to his church is intimate and indissoluble. It forms the basic understanding of our knowledge of the sacrament of matrimony. The source and summit of the authentic love that Christ has for his church is evident in Jesus' graphic discourse from John's Gospel last week, when we hear Jesus tell the disciples that only by eating his flesh and drinking his blood can we have eternal life. The crowd is still trying to wrap their heads around what this means, and we encounter their reaction in today's gospel. We see that in fact, in this moment, many disciples leave him. They walk away. You might be interested to know that this is the first place in sacred scripture where it is ever recorded that people walked away from our Lord. We're led to believe many walked away. They made their choice in that moment out of fear, not love. And we contrast this reaction with Peter's response to Jesus' question. And you can almost hear a little bit of pain in his voice. Do you also want to leave? Peter, speaking for the 12, confesses, Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. But he doesn't stop there. He says, we have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of the Lord. Convinced. This conviction is the essence of Christian life. It is what we are convinced of as well. And as Pope St. John the 23rd said, Christianity is not a complex system of oppressive rules, which the unbeliever describes. Rather, it is peace, joy, love, and a life which is continually renewed. We must assert this truth as confidently as the apostles did, and we must be convinced of it, for it is our greatest treasure, which alone can give meaning and serenity to our daily lives. My brothers and sisters, let us reflect on the courage and love for the Lord lived by the apostles in that moment and for every day thereafter. St. John Chrysostom once said of the apostles, for the good deeds which tax collectors and fishermen were able to accomplish by God's grace, the philosophers, the rulers, and the countless multitudes cannot imagine. He went on to say, how could 12 uneducated men who lived on rivers and wastelands, who perhaps had never been in a city or public square, think of setting out to do battle with the whole world? Yet that's exactly what they did. And that's exactly what is expected of us, to continue that battle. How do you do this? I believe it's from a daily choice through the grace of God. To choose to stand with Christ is a choice that may lead to things we are not sure we want to eat, or to cups we are not sure we can drink. St. Ignatius said, to choose to carry Christ's standard is to welcome poverty, spiritual poverty, and sometimes material poverty. To choose Christ is to prefer rejection over worldly honors. To choose Christ is to joyfully embrace humility for the sake of the gospel. To choose. It can be tough. It can be difficult. The journey is not easy. It will not be easy in the days to come. It never has been. We see that our Lord Jesus Christ, speaking to Saint Rose of Lima, spoke about the trials and tribulations his church would face. He said this, let all men know that grace comes after tribulation. Let them know that without the burden of afflictions, it is impossible to reach the heights of grace. Let them know that the gifts of grace increase as the struggles increase. Let men take care not to stray and be deceived. For this is the only true stairway to paradise. And without the cross, they can find no road to climb to heaven. That's what our Lord told St. Rose of Lima. So, brothers and sisters, today and every day, let us be reassured by the love of Christ for his bride, the church. Let us revel in the courage and love for Christ shown by the apostles. And let us find comfort in the words our Lord shared with St. Rose of Lima. And let us partake of the body and blood of our Lord, which alone can give meaning and serenity to our lives. Focus on true north. Don't let all this distract you. It occurs to me that the apostles chose to remain with Jesus, not for power, not out of fear, not because it was a rational decision. The apostles remained with Jesus because who they fell in with was love. Love. So let us today and every day renew our commitment to choose Christ, to choose love for what we love besides everything.